Hey, everybody. Some of you have seen this glass ball in some of my other videos. And some of you have commented, as well as I have, that this looks a lot like a golf ball. The dimples. These are not really dimples. They're flats. Facets. Whereas these are dimples. And I don't know if you can actually see them. I don't know if the camera's picking it up. Maybe you can see him better on this. This is a rubber practice golf ball. And this is the real McCoy. I know Callaway Golf spent a lot of money with, they had engineers that they hired just for the sole purpose of analyzing the dimples on a golf ball. They came up with many, many, many variations of dimples. I think eventually they settled on one particular pattern of dimple. And that's what they stuck with. Up until that point, golfers tried different golf balls, thinking that one golf ball would be better suited for them than another. So some golfers used one brand of ball, one type of ball, one model of ball, while other golfers used a different one. Seems kind of silly, in my opinion, but you should just have one golf ball designed perfectly and not worry about different dimple variations. But that's just my two cents. Well, like most of you, I have opinions on a lot of different subjects. I don't always talk about them. Actually, I never talk about them, really. It's mesmerizing. Instead of the spinning knife, which that's this. Maybe I should have the spinning glass golf ball. There it goes. It's a nice shade of green. I like that. It kind of reminds me of the the shade of green of this Parker mechanical pencil. This mechanical pencil was made back in somewhere around 1926, 1927. I'm not exactly sure. Right in that area. This is Parker on the side. This is a Dufold mechanical pencil. I have another one. It's a little bit smaller. It's a Dufold Junior mechanical pencil from the same time era, 20s, 1920s. I still use it. I'm going to be using it in this video, I imagine. At least I'm planning to. I had thought about using this Ticonderoga pencil in this video. I'm going to be making a sketch for my next watercolor painting. So that's why I've got the pencil on standby. Some of you have probably seen this little car up in the corner of the video. Yeah, this is a 1/32nd scale model. It's actually a slot car. See, it's got the flag in the braids to pick up the electricity from the track. This particular representation was made by a slot car company called Slot It. And this is a model of a Alfa Romeo. Well, they call it a 33/3. It's kind of a odd name. I think it had another name. I think it was like a, I don't know, I think it was a Tipo 33. Tipo. That doesn't sound right, but maybe it is a Alfa Romeo Tipo 33. And in real life, Alfa had different versions of this. I think they designed this back in the late 60s, 68, I think. Because I know it debuted, you know, it had its first real race in 1969 at the 12 Hours of Sebring, where subsequently it did poorly. It did not do well at all. So I think Alfa was counting on maybe redeeming themselves at Le Mans, but during a practice session, I think for that race, 24 Hours of Le Mans, the one of their drivers was killed in a practice session. So Alfa Romeo did not participate at that Le Mans race that year. So the 33 did win a couple of races that year, but they were smaller races, not very big races. So overall, in the 69 season, they just did not do well. Not as well as they wanted to. The prototype of this car had a V8 engine. It was almost 3,000 cc's. That, I guess in cubic inches, that's going to translate to about 183 cubic inches. It made about 440 horsepower, which is a good bit. But the car only weighed 1,500 pounds, so 440 horsepower in a 1,500 pound car. This thing was, it was incredibly fast, no doubt. It raced in the Group 6 and the Group 5 categories. Group 6 is prototype sports cars. Group 5 was just sports cars. At least that's the way it was then. I guess it still is. Let's just get that out of the way. So yeah, I'm gonna be sketching out a sketch for my next watercolor painting. I'm pretty anxious to get to work on that painting because I have some new paints. And I had been using these paints. These paints are called pan paints. And I don't guess it's because they're in a tin pan. They're just little hard cakes of paint pigment. Whereas my new paints are in tubes. Set that off to the side. Now, these paints were expensive, at least for me. Some of you might look at the price and think, that's no big deal. But it was kind of hard for me to buy these. It's got a price tag on of like $45.99. Yeah, maybe I should have just left it on there, but I don't know. Now, these paints came from Hobby Lobby. And when I make purchases at Hobby Lobby, I do like to pull up their coupon on my cell phone, because it's usually for a pretty good discount. So even though the box said $45.99, I did not pay that much. Now, this brand of paint, it says Grum Bacher. I don't really know how good a brand that is. I don't know if it's probably not the best. It's probably not the worst. It's probably somewhere in between, maybe it performs near the top of its class. I don't have any idea. I'll let you know what I think when I use them. I'm going to take a sip of Gatorade. Hold on. So, you know, I started my simple little watercolor hobby with the pan paints, and now I've graduated to tube paints. And that's not to say that professionals don't use pan paints, because they do. You know, there's certain circumstances where pan paints make sense, especially out in the field. And there's other reasons. And I'll probably talk about some of that during the actual painting video, which this is not the actual painting video. This is just preparation. The caps have a little knurl on it to help you grip it, kind of like the bottles of ink. Let me reach over and get one. And I've always enjoyed just kind of taking my thumbnail and just kind of, I just like the way it sounds. After all, it is a relaxation video, so why not? So I'm hoping that I can produce pretty much any color that I want with this selection of paint. We've got Alizarin Crimson and Burnt Sienna, Cobalt Blue, Phthalo Green, here's a Grum Bacher Red, Cad Yellow, Ultramarine Blue, Yellow Ochre, Chinese White, and Ivory Black. Back in later. And here's a nice little surprise. Just a little mixing, little mixing tray. That's probably going to come in handy because with I mentioned that I hope to produce any color that I want to with these paints. Or maybe I'm a little bit naive and I've got a lot to learn, but I'm hoping that I can take a mixing guide like this and produce the colors that I want. Here's the dominant colors and the mixing colors. And I don't know if I have all of them. There's the Cad Yellow and the Paleo Blue, Paleo Green. Yeah. Maybe I spoke too soon. But I think you take a little bit of this and a little bit of this and follow it up and you end up with that. Kind of see how that works. It doesn't have to be a science. If I come out with anything halfway close to what I had hoped to, I'll be happy. It doesn't take much to make me happy. I try to appreciate the small things. And, you know, because of that, I'm just pretty easy. I guess I'm easy to please. I do appreciate quality, though, so when it comes to poor quality, I'm a lot harder to please because I appreciate quality. quality things tend to last, and I like things that last. I like things that are durable, that can stand the test of time. Much like this pencil from the 1920s, this pencil's close to 100 years old. I still use it. As I do this pencil, which is also close to 100 years old. And I have other old pencils that I like to use. I'm going to take this piece of sandpaper. I've got a new piece of lead in here, so I'm just going to break the edge on it. I'm kind of rotating the lead as I do this. Yeah, that's what I want. Perfect. Yeah, things of quality tend to last. My old truck is, I say old. I don't mean it's like from the 50s or anything. It's like from, the early 2000s. But it is, getting close to 20 years old, and it's lasting. We're going to use a piece of this watercolor paper made by, and I'm not even sure how to pronounce it, Bienfang. You can tell me in the comments how to pronounce this. I have no idea. So, I wonder if I can zoom out a little bit. Nope. That's as far as it goes. That's fine. I'm gonna make some marks on the paper, kind of where I envision things to be. Where's halfway? Maybe right about there. There's a thing in photography called the rule of thirds, where if you compose a shot, it's kind of hard to explain, but if I draw a line, if I split this three ways and draw a line here and maybe one here, and then a line here and here into like a grid, if you compose the shot so that your features follow those thirds, those grid lines that you drew, it's pleasing to the eye, is what they say. So if you're not sure, obviously I did not articulate the rule of thirds as well as I could have. That would require a demonstration, but just look it up. And if you're not using the rule of thirds, you should try when you take pictures, because your pictures will be much better. So let's see. We're going to make a happy little stream. maybe the rule of thirds would have right about here. I think I'll have the stream kind of meandering down. So if I can kind of just kind of sketch, and you probably can't even see the pencil marks, but they're there. Yeah, maybe like that. And up here, I'm just kind of, it just kind of goes along with bits of gray, the land jutting out into it. Yeah, that's the way I want it. And maybe there'd be a tree line over here. Sky above. And I think right here, maybe a tree. Yeah, that'll be my basic shapes. Now, I did that kind of lightly because it doesn't need to be anything dark. I don't want it to show through the paint. At least that's my thinking anyway. So we're going to just put that off to the side. And when it's time to do the actual painting video, That's what I'm gonna paint. This is one nice pencil. Got some, you're holding something when you have this pencil in your hand. It's got some heft to it. It's very nice. It's my, case, mini copper lock pocket knife. I think I showed that to you recently. It's kind of a treat to myself. A person shouldn't really blow their money on lots of frivolous things, but sometimes you just need to do something for yourself. This has been a crazy year for all of us with this pandemic and everything. 2020 kind of started out pretty rough for me. My wife was sick, and we're looking back at it now, and we're thinking that maybe she possibly had this COVID-19, this coronavirus. We're not sure. But it was pretty rough, and she almost died. And then, like a month after she got out of the hospital, she had to go back in because it seemed like it had come back. So, Mrs. Relaxing ASMR's had a tough time of it. And now lots of people are having a tough time. So 2020's been crazy. Trying to figure out where you can get masks and rubber gloves and toilet paper but we just do the best we can. I'm trying to stay busy. Many people have essential jobs and they gotta keep on working. Thank goodness for that. The people working in the grocery stores especially, should be commended. And I hope that they're getting some kind of, wage increase for this, during this time, because if they haven't, they deserve it. The grocery stores are making more money than they ever have, and these people that are working in them are risking getting sick by being so close to everybody during this time. So I sure hope they're being treated right when it comes to their wages. And of course, the healthcare workers that are on the front line, so many of them are getting this and dying from it. But hey, this is just me talking. I'm not an expert in any of this. I just know what I read, what I hear. And when it comes to this thing, you hear so much, it can become difficult to figure out what's true, what's not. It'll all work out somehow or another. But I'll use this opportunity to thank you guys for hanging out at my channel. You know, it just occurred to me at this very moment that my channel has fairly new banner artwork on it that one of my viewers actually created. He created the banner that you see on my channel. And he, sent it to me in an email free of charge. And I've been so busy. I've been so distracted with my wife that I never got around to publicly thanking that person for creating the banner that's on my channel. It's a great banner. It kind of shows my desktop. And there's, there's hints of the things that I enjoy. So check out the main page of my channel. And when I get a chance, I'm going to be looking up, going back into my emails and looking up this person's name, because I told them that I would mention them, and I just basically I forgot. But you know who you are, the person that did the banner. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
I do appreciate it very much. Now, here's the Dixon Ticonderoga. The packaging says the world's best pencil. Well, maybe the world's best wooden pencil, perhaps. I have no reason to doubt their claim. I've always thought they were really, really nice pencils myself. You know, I think I'll zoom in on that a little bit. And now that I've done that, I may need to adjust the focus a little. Problem with a sharpener like this is when you get down to this point, if you're not very careful, you could break the graphite. And even if you are careful, you can still break the graphite. If you break the graphite, undoubtedly a piece will remain in the sharpener, thus making it impossible to push the pencil all the way in to get the point that you desire. I suspect that could possibly be the issue right now. Actually, it seems clear. Clear of any broken pieces of graphite. The graphite feels loose. I can wiggle it. Oh well. Made by Dixon, D-I-X-O-N, Dixon. Ticondaroga. Ticondaroga. Ran out of room. Well, this old Parker mechanical pencil definitely has a different feel to it. I think the lead must be softer in here. Yeah, I won. But anyhow, this video is, it's approaching an hour long. Got a lot to do today. I'm gonna shine a pair of my shoes that could use a good shoe shine. I thought about doing that in a video, and I probably will. Every man should know how to shine his shoes. But if you don't, you can watch me and maybe learn a thing or two. As I do a kind of a, just a basic shoe shine, just to kind of, you know, snazz them up a little bit. They've got some wear on them. So in the next video, you're either going to see me shining a pair of shoes or painting the stream out there in the woods. So, I would like to have a video that was an hour long, if possible. So, for the next couple of minutes, I'm just going to sit here and do this. And if you've managed to watch all of this, all the way up to this point, I'm going to give you the secret word, which I have not done in some time. And the secret word is... how about well, I was going to say caliper, but that's not really fun to say. So we're going to say it's more than one word. It's going to be chicken noodle soup. That's the secret phrase. Chicken noodle soup. And that's probably what I'm going to have for lunch. It's almost 2 inches across. It lacks about 10 thousandths of an inch being 2 inches. Well, all right, this is getting kind of ridiculous. I feel like I'm making one of those other types of, one of those other type of ASMR videos. One of those, tapping, tap, tap, tap. I don't think that's me, so we're going to stop this video right here. You're probably already asleep, so if not, good night. Thanks for watching.